Okay, a word of welcome for the last talk of our workshop, Natural History, Mathematics, and Metaphysics in the 17th century, but also the last selfies seminar of the year, of the academic year. We had a very productive and fruitful year this year with almost every week. We had our Wednesday seminar, and I'm very pleased to have this kind of last seminar of the academic year to have here Peter Anstey, who reminded me that this is, he was in Romania for the first time 10 years ago, and since he came more than once. His talk tonight is going to be on Locke and Leibniz and collision.
Thank you, Dana. I'd like to start just by thanking Dana and Nia for all their hospitality, all the organisation, and what a great job they've done for all of us here who've been at the workshop over the last couple of days. So Locke and Leibniz on cohesion. Sometimes the bringing together of loosely related texts can illuminate a subject. And in the case of early modern theories of cohesion, there's a cluster of passages in Locke and Leibniz that can be used as a window into a whole host of issues pertaining to the nature and behavior of matter. In this paper, I'm going to examine two passages on cohesion in Locke's essay concerning human understanding, three passages in Leibniz's philosophical commentary on the essay, called the New Essays Concerning Human Understanding, and I'm going to supplement this with an exposition of a letter from Leibniz to Hartsacker, and round it off with some comments on his earlier Specimen Dynamicum. And the aim of all of this is correctly to frame the problem of cohesion in the mature philosophy of both Locke and Leibniz. So we're going to look at a range of texts and try and see what the philosophical issues are and how Leibniz's understanding of the nature of cohesion is in a sense shaped by his polemical engagement with Locke. So we start with Locke and then we move on to Leibniz. Locke's views on the nature of matter changed in important ways from the early drafts of the essay written in 1671 to the published version of the work, which appeared in 1690. And I'm only going to speak about his mature view. In order to clarify Locke's notion of cohesion, we need first to set out his notion of solidity. And this is the subject of Book 2, Chapter 4 of the essay, where solidity is defined as the resistance we find in body to the entrance of any other body into the place it possesses till it has left it. So that's his definition of solidity. The idea of solidity is a simple idea. Locke has a complex taxonomy of ideas, but solidity is one of the very simple ones, one of the ones that we acquire through the senses. We derive it, in fact, from the sense of touch. It's the same idea as impenetrability, though impenetrability is a negative idea, and Locke expresses a preference for the term solidity over impenetrability in the way we name that particular idea. Solidity for Locke is a property of all material things. We perceive it in large bodies, and we infer that it's in the minutest particle of matter that can exist, and the mind finds it inseparably inherent in body wherever or however modified. Now, Locke gives some experimental evidence for this claim, though in my view it's not clear that he's accurately reported the experimental results. They're from the Academia del Cimento, and but I think that's beside the point. This is really ultimately a philosophical thesis. The idea derives from sensation, but he's making this what we'd call a kind of inductive or transductive generalization. That what we experience in medium-sized bodies and large bodies, we infer exists in the minutest parts of bodies. Now, more importantly, for Locke, solidity is essential to matter. And he says, this of all other, the idea of solidity, seems the idea most intimately connected with and essential to body, so as nowhere else to be found or imagined, but only in matter. And Locke seems, therefore, to be committed to the strong biconditional, that's this reasoning both ways, that an object is solid if and only if it's material. So if it's solid, then it's material, and if it's material, then it's solid. This is why he can speak of us allowing a thinking thing without solidity, that is immaterial, to exist. And the thing that lacks solidity is immaterial, not material. A further crucial point about solidity is Locke's doctrine of repletion, the notion of repletion. Solid bodies fill the entire space that they occupy. Solidity consists in repletion. Two things follow from this. First, it follows that solidity is an irreducibly intensive quality. And secondly, if a body can be compressed, it's because it contains pores that are empty. Empty space. For example, if you compare water with a diamond, and you place a small bit of water between two marble slabs and a diamond between two other marble slabs, this is what Locke says. The parts of water, if they could be kept from making place by that side or lateral motion, they would eternally hinder the approach of these two pieces of marble as much as the diamond. One way of bringing out the doctrine of repletion is to compare solidity with hardness. Bodies can be more or less hard, but they can't be more or less solid. Finally, solidity is conceived by Locke as a monadic property. A lonely corpuscle would be solid. If all there was in the whole world was just one lonely corpuscle, it would be solid. There's nothing relative about it. So, solidity, therefore, provides the basis for the distinction between the extension of matter and the expansion of space. And Locke prefers to say that matter is extended, but space is expanded. This is something he brought into the essay and developed further as new editions of the essay appeared. Bodies are extended insofar as they have cohering, solid, separable, movable parts. Space is expanded insofar as it has continuous, penetrable, immovable parts. Locke sets that out in Book 2, Chapter 4, Section 5. Okay, so that's Locke on solidity. Let's now turn to cohesion. Locke's most sustained discussion occurs at Essay 2, Chapter 23. Starting with extension, this is defined as nothing more than the... we're up to here. Okay. It's defined as... nothing more but the cohesion of solid parts. So that's what extension is. Cohesion is a relation between solid parts. So it's a polyadic property. Okay, so you think of, you know, green, and, you know, the leaf is green, in between is a polyadic property, so the clicker is in between me and the lectern. It's a relational property. Okay, so it's to be distinguished, so cohesion is to be distinguished from hardness, insofar as hardness and softness are degrees of cohesion. So here's how Locke puts it. Hardness consists in a firm cohesion of the parts of matter, making up masses of a sensible bulk, so that the whole does not easily change its figure. Now, as for the nature of our idea of cohesion, we do not have a clear and distinct idea of it. Locke says to me, it seems to me as incomprehensible as the manner of thinking. So the idea of cohesion is as incomprehensible as the nature of thought and how thought is performed. Now, on the question of the cause of cohesion, Locke throws up his hands and says, I don't know. He does, however, have strong views about what the cause is not. Now, I want to extrapolate a little bit, and I want to give you four putative causes of cohesion, four ways that we might want to explain cohesion. So the first one is external pressure of the ambient air or ether. This is a popular theory in the latter half of the 17th century. A second cause of cohesion might be interpenetration, so that when two bodies cohere, they overlap. A third cause, attractive forces. And a fourth cause is motion. Now, of these four putative causes, Locke only discusses one, namely the explanation of cohesion by the appeal to the ambient air or ether. And he discusses this view at length, and he dismisses it in chapter 23, to which I've alluded already. He offers three different arguments against it. The theory that he's attacking is Yaqub Bernoulli's theory. Even though Bernoulli is not mentioned in the essay, he is mentioned in the abrogé, which is the French summary of the essay that was published in the Bibliothèque Universelle in 1688. So we know that Bernoulli is the target, even though his name is raised from the first edition of the essay, from all editions of the essay. Here are the three arguments that Locke runs against Bernoulli. Firstly, there's the regress argument. This is the idea that if the air, say, or the ether, particles of the air or ether are responsible for the cohesion of bodies, then what is it that makes the particles of the air cohere? And if something makes them cohere, well then, what is it that makes that thing that makes the air cohere? And you can see we're off on a vicious regress, rather nasty. Lateral movement argument has to do with movements coming from lateral directions, and the bonded universe argument. I won't go into these arguments here because I've discussed them elsewhere, except to say that Leibniz, in the new essays, endorses Locke's lateral movement argument. And he agrees that this first putative cause of cohesion, the ether theory, or the ambient fluid, or air theory, is wrong. Okay, as for cohesion by interpenetration, there is one other doctrine held by Locke that bears on this account of cohesion, though to my knowledge, Locke never drew the connection between this thesis and his doctrine of cohesion. And this is one of the principles of individuation that he sets out in the chapter entitled Of Identity and Diversity, which was added to the second edition of the essay. In section 2 of that chapter, Locke sets out a number of principles of individuation from which he will develop an account of identity over time. He states that there are three sorts of... He states that there are three sorts of substances. They are God, finite spirits or intelligences, and bodies. And he goes on to stipulate an exclusion principle. And here's the exclusion principle. We've got three types of substance, and Locke says this: for though these three types, sorts of substance, as we term them, do not exclude one another out of the same, one another out of the same place, yet we cannot conceive but that they must necessarily, each of them, exclude any of the same kind out of the same place. Or else the notions and names of identity and diversity would be in vain, and there could be no such distinction of substances or anything else from one another. So while God and a body might occupy the same space. Two bodies can't occupy the same space at the same time. Now, this exclusion principle, when combined with Locke's doctrine of repletion, entails that cohesion cannot be some form of interpenetration. However, Locke never explicitly draws this implication, nor does he discuss cohesion as caused by an attractive power or as caused by motion. There's another claim in Locke in the chapter on identity and diversity that bears importantly on his view of cohesion, and that is the principle of individuation for basic compound substances such as clusters of atoms or corpuscles. At section 3 of this chapter, this is chapter 27 in book 2, Locke claims the following. If two or more atoms be joined together in the same mass, every one of those atoms will be the same. The mass consisting of the same atoms must be the same mass or the same body, let the parts be never so differently jumbled. But if one of these atoms be taken away, or one new one added, it's no longer the same mass or the same body. Now, we can be certain here that being joined refers to cohesion, because Locke goes on to compare masses with living bodies, such as an oak tree, and he speaks of the mass there as only the cohesion of particles of matter anyhow united. So referring back to masses of stuff versus organized living bodies, and he speaks of them the cohesion of bodies there. So it's clear then that cohesion provides a principle of individuation for masses of matter, even though Locke doesn't connect up this claim either with his earlier discussion of cohesion. So Locke's conclusion after his extended discussion of the nature of cohesion is that our failure to have a clear and distinct idea of cohesion means that we don't understand how bodies can be extended. So this is rather pessimistic. We don't have a clear and distinct idea of what it is in virtue of which bodies are extended, so we can't even explain what what extension is. It's bad news for a natural philosophy that's going to have matter as a central constituent. Okay, that's Locke. We need Locke because we want to understand Leibniz. So section 2 is on Leibniz, on Locke, and cohesion in the new essays. So we're concerned here with Leibniz's thoughts on cohesion from around 1703 to 1711. Right at the time that monads had entered into his metaphysics. Three issues that I'm not going to address here, but which impinge on Leibniz's discussion of cohesion, are firstly his two levels of matter, primary and secondary matter. You'll see that in one or two of the passages we're going to look at in a minute. I'm also not going to discuss the nature of forces. Very difficult issue, but it is relevant to some of what I'm going to say. And I'm not going to discuss the relation of the problem of cohesion to the problem of continuity and individuation and individuation and the role of monads in individuation. So I'm just setting all that aside. This is not a dumbed-down version of Leibniz's discussion of cohesion, but I think the best way into cohesion with Leibniz is to ignore some of the more complex ramifications of his views for other parts of his metaphysics. Now, Leibniz discusses Locke's view of cohesion three times in the new essays. The first discussion is in the preface of pages 59 to 60 in the Bennett edition, and it's in a section in which Leibniz distinguishes his view of matter from Locke's view of matter. And this is how he starts off, being very generous because of his great respect for Locke. He says this, and of course this is originally in French, and we have distributed all these readings in French and in English and Latin. So if you want to examine the broader context, the readings are available. This gifted author, says Leibniz of Locke, goes so far as to believe that rigidity, or the cohesion of its tiny parts, constitutes the essence of body. Rather, we should think of space as full of matter, which is inherently fluid or capable of every sort of division, and indeed actually divided and subdivided to infinity. But with this difference, that how it is divisible and divided varies from place to place because of variations in the extent to which the movements in it run the same way. That is, what brings it about that matter has everywhere some degree of rigidity as well as fluidity, and that no body is either hard or fluid in the ultimate degree, we find it in no way invincibly hard. No invincibly hard atoms and no mass which is entirely unresistant to division. Leibniz claims that for Locke, quote, cohesion of its tiny parts constitutes the essence of body. But as we've already seen, this is not really quite Locke's view. Locke regards solidity and mobility and the power to communicate motion by impulse to be the essence of matter, and these together with cohesion to the essence of extended body. So Leibniz also implies that Locke identifies rigidity with cohesion. But we've seen that for Locke, rigidity is a species of hardness, which is a relative measure of cohesion. Bodies can be more or less hard or rigid, but they can't be more or less solid. For Leibniz, matter has everywhere some degree of rigidity as well as of fluidity, and that no body is either hard or fluid in the ultimate degree. We find in it no invincibly hard atoms and no mass which is entirely unresistant to division. Now this really does bring out the nature of the difference between these two philosophers. For Leibniz, because the world is a planum and matter is infinitely divisible, Locke's solidity just is rigidity of parts. There is no ultimate degree of hardness, no irreducibly intensive solidity. For Locke, because matter is fundamentally solid, rigidity can only be understood as degree of cohesion of solid parts. One man's modus ponens is another man's modus tollens, as we say in the business. Leibniz claims somewhat elliptically that his position is based on the order of nature and the law of continuity. Now, the law of continuity is the thesis that there are no gaps or jumps in matter and the way it behaves. Locke, however, is committed neither to atomism nor to infinite divisibility. The latter is something about which he declares that he doesn't really know what the answer is. He says, "For I would fain have instanced anything in our notion of spirit more perplexed or nearer a contradiction than the very notion of body includes in it. The divisibility in infinitum of any finite extension involving us, whether we grant or deny it, in consequences impossible to be explicated or made in our apprehensions consistent. Consequences that carry greater difficulty and more apparent absurdity than anything can follow from the notion of an immaterial knowing substance." Here again he is contrasting our ignorance about the nature of matter with our ignorance of the nature of immaterial and thinking things. It seems, therefore, that we're at an impasse. Incompatible starting points lead to two quite different accounts of cohesion. Leibniz then intimates what his view of the cause of cohesion really is, and he rules out an alternative view, namely that cohesion is the result of a kind of force. Here is what he says. "I have also shown that cohesion, which is not itself the result of impulse or motion, would cause traction, strictly so called. For given an inherently rigid body, like an Epicurean atom, part of which stuck out in the form of a hook, since we can imagine atoms of every kind of shape, then the pressure on this hook would draw the rest of the atom with it. That is, would draw the part on which there was no pressure and which did not lie in the line of the impulse. Yet our gifted author is himself opposed to these philosophic tractions, such as those which used to be ascribed to the fear of a vacuum. He reduces them to impulses, maintaining with the moderns that one part of matter operates immediately on another only by pushing against it. I think that they are right about that, since otherwise the process would be unintelligible. Now we're going to return to Leibniz's view, positive view, in due course. Now I'd like to focus on his rejection of the view that cohesion is a form of traction caused by a kind of force between material parts. For example, the force that enables the hook to attach to the rest of the atom. This is the third of the four putative causes that we listed above. Leibniz claims that Locke denies this, that Locke denies the explanation of traction for cohesion. Though he goes on to note that in Locke's correspondence with Stillingfleet, he reneges from his commitment to the view that, quote, bodies operate by impulse and nothing else, end quote. And he reneges on this in the light of Newton's discovery that gravity is a force of attraction in all bodies. Leibniz regards this as a modest, even pious, but ultimately unjustifiable concession to Newton. And he sees it as the thin end of a very undesirable wedge. Once one inexplicable case of action at a distance, or traction, is admitted, here's what Leibniz says, I would not like to be compelled to resort to miracles in the ordinary course of nature, or to admit absolutely inexplicable powers and operations. For with the aid of what God can do, we may give too much leeway to bad philosophy by admitting these centripetal powers and immediate attractions at a distance without being able to make them intelligible. I do not see what is to prevent our scholastics from saying that everything simply comes about through faculties. Now we should point out, however, that Locke nowhere entertains the possibility that an attractive force is the cause of cohesion between parts of bodies. Leibniz is exploring an implication of Locke's acceptance of universal gravity that Locke never followed up in his writings. Well, what's Leibniz's considered alternative view to the attractive force then? Attractive force as an explanation of cohesion. Well, we find the answer later in the new essays in Leibniz's commentary on Locke's long discussion of cohesion in Book 2. So we're jumping from the preface of the new essays to towards the end of Book 2 of the essays. Remember that the new essays is a section-by-section, chapter-by-chapter, book-by-book commentary on Locke's essays. So the structure of it maps exactly the Pierre Coste edition, 1700 edition, of the French translation of Locke's essay. Where Locke claims that one explains extension by cohesion of parts, Leibniz claims cohesion of parts appears not to be necessary to make an extended whole, since perfectly rarefied and fluid matter may be said to be made up an extended thing without its parts being joined to one another. Ostensibly, Leibniz is simply denying Locke's central claim. Fluid matter that lacks cohesion can be extended, so cohesion is not necessary for extension. However, there's a more subtle shift in the terms of reference here. For Locke, solidity is essential to each material part, and cohesion is the binding relation that enables the individuation of non-living masses of matter. By contrast, for Leibniz, the concern is not with individuated bodies, but with states of matter. The shift is from Locke's solidity as an essential and unifying property with its implications for individuation, determined by the binding relation of cohesion, to Leibniz's solidity as a state of matter on a continuum from absolute fluidity to absolute rigidity. On Leibniz's account, solidity can only be understood relative to fluidity. And Leibniz reiterates this in his discussion of cohesion in section 27 of chapter 3, book 2. Here is what he says. It seems to me that if a body has, as I believe all bodies always do have, internal movements going on, i.e. if its parts are engaged in pulling away from one another, it is still extended for all that. So the notion of extension appears to me to be totally different from that of cohesion. Clearly, bodies can be extended in spite of their parts being in motion, yet for Leibniz, the cause of material states just is motion. In fact, Leibniz again, though I think that perfect fluidity is appropriate only to primary matter, i.e. to matter in the abstract considered as an original quality like motionlessness, but it does not fit secondary matter, i.e. matter as it actually occurs, invested with its derivative qualities, for I believe that no mass is ultimately rarefied and that there is some degree of bonding everywhere. And this is produced by motions when they all run the same way, so that any division would have to set up cross currents, which cannot happen without some turbulence and resistance. Now we're going to set aside, as I said, the distinction between primary and secondary matter. The key point to notice at this juncture is the claim that cohesion is caused by motions. The bonding, that's Leibniz's term, of the parts of a cohering body is caused by motions that, quote, run the same way. And division is caused by, we assume, the impact of matter with lateral motions. And that's why Leibniz approves of Locke's lateral movement argument. Let's turn now to the third passage, Leibniz's commentary on Locke's chapter on solidity. So we've looked at Leibniz's preface, Leibniz on Locke on cohesion, and now we're going to look at Leibniz on Locke on solidity. Here, we're able to fill out the picture a bit more. Leibniz admits that some bodies have a power of resistance, but he claims that this arises from several different causes. He says here, it's worth bearing in mind that the resistance which occurs in matter arises in it, arises from it in more than one way, and for rather different reasons. First, there's a body's resistance to occupy the same place as another body. It can be said in a general way that this resistance comes from the reluctance of two bodies to share the same place, which can be called impenetrability. For where one exerts itself to enter the place, it also exerts itself to drive the other out or prevent it from entering it. Just what this form of impenetrability amounts to is not yet clear. Two sources of resistance lie in the body itself, and another source in the neighbouring bodies. As for internal sources of resistance, first there is inertia that, quote, renders matter resistant to motion, so that force must be expended to move a body independently of its having weight or being bonded to other things. So that's inertia. And secondly, for bodies in motion, the impetus amounts to a power of resistance, insofar as a body with impetus will not yield easily when it's moving to a given place. Leibniz then turns to a third cause of resistance in bodies, namely the bonding between parts of a body. And here is what he says. Quite a long extract, but I'll read the whole thing. Now, a new element enters the picture. Namely, the firmness or the bonding of one body to another. This bonding often results in one's being unable to push one body without at the same time pushing another, which is bonded to it. So there's a kind of traction of the second body. Because of this bonding, there would be resistance, even if there were no inertia or manifest impetus, the other two causes of resistance. For if space is conceived as full of perfectly fluid matter, which has neither inertia nor impetus, and a single hard body is placed in it, there'll be no resistance to the bodies being moved. But if space were full of small cubes, a hard body would encounter resistance to its being moved among them. This is because the little cubes, just because they were hard, i.e. because their parts were bonded together, would be difficult to split up finely enough to permit circular movement, in which the position being evacuated by the moving body would at once be refilled by something else. One must ask, however, in a world without inertia or impetus, what's the source of the hardness of the single hard body and of the resisting cubes? For Leibniz, it can only be bonding. But what's bonding? He goes on to tell us, in my opinion, this bonding of bodies results from more attenuated movements of bodies towards one another. That is, motion. But bonding that results from motion is going to require resistance, and resistance will require either inertia and impetus, both of which are ruled out by the thought experiment, or it will require impenetrability. Leibniz then uses the example of two bodies being placed at the same time at either end of a tight-fitting tube, and claims that the matter which was already in the tube, however fluid it might be, would resist just because of its sheer impenetrability. So the idea is that we've got a long tube, we put some matter in one end and matter at the other, and that matter will never touch because of the impenetrability of the matter in the middle. Remember, we're working with a planum here. So, Leibniz goes on to say, the phenomenon of resistance which we are considering involves the impenetrability of bodies, inertia, impetus, and bonding. So Leibniz admits that his account of bonding is disputable and shouldn't be presupposed. Okay, so he's hedging his bets. Nor, however, should the thesis that there is, quote, an inherent essential solidity which makes the place occupied always equal to the thing which occupies it. End quote. That, of course, is Locke's view. Leibniz is not ruling out impenetrability to occur here. Rather, he is denying that there is absolute impenetrability, that is, what we've called solidity as an irreducibly intensive quality. The upshot of Leibniz's whole discussion of Locke's chapter on solidity is not particularly satisfying in light of his other remarks on cohesion in the new essays. He introduces a form of non-absolute impenetrability without explaining its cause. He claims that there is a bonding between parts of matter that's caused by motions, but he doesn't elaborate. And he uses a thought experiment concerning an inertia and impetus-free planum that contains a hard material object without explaining in virtue of what that object is hard. To be sure, the new essays doesn't contain a carefully worked out physics, and in some ways it's a reactive work using Locke's philosophy as its reference frame rather than Leibniz's own system. And moreover, the work was never polished up for publication because Locke died before Leibniz had finished it, and he felt that he really shouldn't put it out after Locke's death. Nevertheless, it does leave many questions unanswered concerning Leibniz's view on cohesion. So, we turn then to Leibniz's correspondence with Hartzinger. Some of Leibniz's ideas can be clarified to a certain extent by turning to his later correspondence with Nicholas Hartzinger from 1711. Here we find exactly the same dialectical moves, though in this instance the focus is on atomism rather than on cohesion. So let's look at the letter. You, Hartzinger, say your atoms have no parts, and you think it strange that I should suppose one may conceive that an atom A has two parts, B and C. But you're not obliged to own that anyone may conceive that an atom D goes against the atom A without going directly against the part B. and in such a manner that it would carry C along with it and leave B behind if A were not an atom or a solid body. There is therefore some reason to affirm that the pretended atom is not without parts. You must assign causes of its atomity, if I may so speak, that is, why D cannot carry C along with it without carrying B at the same time. And you must find a strong glue to make one of those parts stick to the other if you're not willing to have recourse to the conspiring motion. Conspiring motion is what Leibniz is arguing for. Now, this is an analogous argument to that in the preface of the New Essays, except there Leibniz used a hook instead of a part B, and uniform motion in a right line rather than a lateral motion. Okay, so we had the hook pulling the atom along, whereas here we've got an atom with two parts, one part of which gets hit from a lateral motion. Leibniz is saying, what is it that causes the other part of the atom to go along with it? So it really is the completely analogous thought experiment. And Leibniz draws the same moral. He tells Hartsucker, if you allege only the will of God for it, you have recourse to a miracle. Remember, he used that term against Locke. And even to a perpetual miracle. In the New Essays, he claims against Locke, I would not like to be compelled to resort to miracles in the ordinary course of nature. In both cases, he refers to an attractive force of gravity as an explanation of planetary motions as being a miracle as well. Pointed reference to Newton. As if the example of gravity is not enough to undermine Hartsucker's atomism, Leibniz runs the same line against hardness. So even though he's discussing atomism, the same issues are coming up. The same ought to be said of hardness. If anyone acknowledges that the mechanism which occasions hardness is unknown to him, he's in the right. But if he pretends that hardness proceeds from any other cause than mechanism, and if he has recourse to a primitive hardness, as the asserters of atoms do, he recurs to a quality so occult that it can never be made clear. So, in the final analysis, for Leibniz, the problem with atomism is identical to the problem of positing primitive hardness, that is, solidity in bodies. Thus, sir, you see why God could not create atoms, that is, bodies hard by their own nature. That's Locke's solid parts of matter. Bodies of a primitive and insuperable hardness not to be accounted for. As he could not create planets that should move round of themselves without any cause that should prevent their removing through the tangent. For a miracle at least must keep the planet in and prevent the separation of the parts of a hard body. If a mechanical or an intelligible cause does not do it. So here we've got the problem of atomism and the problem of cohesion are just like the problem of planetary motion. We don't want to solve these problems by appealing to occult qualities or to forces or attractions. The problem for Locke's account of cohesion and solidity is the same as that of Newton's account of the motion of the planets. Okay. The last passage we're going to look at. Leibniz on cohesion in the Specimen Dynamicum. This work has two parts, and the first part was published in 1695. The second part was only published posthumously, so it was not available in this period that we're interested in. It predates the New Essays by about 8 years. Now I'm going to quote in extenso here. I'm going to give you quite a long slab of text. And what I want you to do as we go through this is to pick up the same dialectical moves that we've seen in the comments on Locke's essay and in the correspondence with Hartsucker. See if you can pick them up as we go along. So this is the critique of the appealing to miracles, the allusion to Newton's account of gravity, the problems for atomism, and so on. So here we go. From what we have said, We can also understand that the action of bodies is never without reaction, and both are equal to one another and directed in opposite directions. Also, since only force and the nisus, or tendency arising from it, exist at any moment, for motion never really exists, as we've already discussed, and since every nisus tends in a straight line, it follows that all motion is either rectilinear or composed of rectilinear motions, straight line motions. From this, it not only follows that what moves in a curved path always tries to proceed in a straight line, tangent to it, but also something utterly unexpected, that the true notion of solidity derives from this. Nothing is really solid or fluid, absolutely speaking, and everything has a certain degree of solidity or fluidity, which term we apply to a thing derives from the predominant appearance it presents to our senses.
There's the relativity point, the state
of body. For if we assume something we call solid is rotating around its centre, its parts will try to fly off on the tangent. Indeed, they will actually begin to fly off. But since this mutual separation disturbs the motion of the surrounding bodies in the planar, remember, they're repelled back. Those bits flying off will repel back. That is, thrust back together again, as if the centre contained a magnetic force for attracting them, or as if the parts themselves contained a centripetal force, a force directing them to the centre. Thus, the rotation arises from the composition of the rectilinear tendency or nisus for receding on the tangent and the centripetal canatus power on the parts. Thus, all curvilinear circular motion arises from the straight line or rectilinear tendencies composed with one another, and at the same time, it's understood that all solidity, that's what we're interested in, is caused by surrounding bodies pushing a hard body together. If matters were otherwise, then it could not happen that all curvilinear motion, all circular motion, is composed of pure rectilinear motions. And from this, we also get a new argument against atoms. Should be thinking of Hartsucker now. A new argument against atoms. That is no less unexpected than the one before. Moreover, nothing can be imagined farther from things than the claim that solidity derives from rest, for there is never any true rest in bodies, nor can anything come from rest but rest. Let us grant that A and B are at rest with respect to each other, if not truly at rest, then at least relatively. And let us grant that whatever is at rest at one time will always be at rest, unless put into motion by a new cause. But it doesn't follow that on account of that, since B resists being impelled, it also resists being separated from the other body. So that if one were to overcome the resistance of B, that is, if one were to put B in motion, A would immediately follow. Same thought experiment as we have with Hartsucker, analogous to the one with Locke in the USA. But if there were attraction, something not found in nature, but found in Newton, if there were attraction, attraction explained either from primitive solidity, like we have in Locke, or through rest, or something similar, then this would certainly have followed. And so, we should not explain solidity except through the surrounding bodies pushing the bodies together. The mutual pressure alone is insufficient to explain the matter, as if only A hindered the departure of B. But we must understand that the bodies do indeed separate one from another. However, one is driven back to the other by the surrounding bodies, and thus, from the combination of these two motions, the conjunction is preserved. And so, those who imagine certain planks or insensible plates in bodies, planks or plates whose separation is made difficult because of the resistance of the surrounding bodies, and from this explains the solidity of hard sensible bodies, even if they might be often right, these people don't give the ultimate explanation of solidity, since they assume some solidity of the plates. I think we've had enough of that. The focus of Leibniz in this passage is on the compound nature of curvilinear motions and its implications for solidity. First, as we saw in the new essays, solidity is always relative to fluidity and is a state of bodies. Nothing's really solid or fluid, absolutely speaking, says Leibniz. Everything has a certain degree of solidity or fluidity. Yet the focus in the Specimen Dynamicum is on curvilinear motions and the manner in which the surrounding bodies prevent the parts from flying off at the tangent. All solidity is caused by surrounding bodies, says Leibniz, pushing a body together. Leibniz's primitive, though non-absolute impenetrability is absent, and so too is any discussion of bonding, which we saw in the essays. What does feature is both the argument against atomism as found against Locke and Hartsacker, and the swipe at certain philosophical opinions of certain important mathematicians. That was the bit I didn't read out, i.e. Newton. They go beyond what they should, and posit empty space and don't shrink from attraction. They also take motion to be an absolute thing and strive to prove this from rotation and the centrifugal force that arises from it, says Leibniz. Leibniz views solidity as a state, the converse of fluidity, and as such, it's a relation of relative property. So, conclusion. If we return to our four putative causes of cohesion, we're now in a position to compare Locke's view with that of Leibniz. First, cohesion is caused by external pressure of the ambient air or ether. This view is rejected by Locke and by Leibniz. Locke deploys three arguments against it in the essay. Leibniz affirms Locke's lateral movement argument, though there is a sense in which Leibniz's view is close to this putative cause because he admits surrounding bodies as a cause of cohesion in the plane. Second putative cause, cohesion is caused by interpenetration. This view is precluded by Locke's doctrine of repletion together with his exclusion principle for the individuation of substances, though Locke doesn't discuss this in relation to the problem of cohesion. An interpenetration account of cohesion was held by the early Leibniz, so I'm told, but was abandoned in 1676. Leibniz is always changing his views. Thirdly, cohesion as caused by attractive forces. This view is not discussed by Locke, but Leibniz shows that Locke's concession to action at a distance in the case of gravity gives Locke room to endorse such a view, and Leibniz himself is emphatically opposed to it, regarding it as tantamount to having recourse to miracles or occult qualities. And he makes this point in all of his later discussions of cohesion and solidity. Fourthly and finally, cohesion as caused by motion. This view is not discussed by Locke. It is, however, the position that the later Leibniz takes, as spelt out in the second unpublished part of his Specimen Dynamicum of 1695, and alluded to, though not set out with much clarity, in the new essays and the correspondence with Hartsacker. Thank you.
Right, plenty of time for questions. You got it.
You said that for Locke, solidity is a monadic property. So
yes.
You have
when
just
you
one
up?
Body in the universe, it would be still solid.
Mm.
It's just that the definition of solidity made appeal to at least two bodies. That is, that a body does not allow another body to take its place. So if you have just one body in the universe, how can you know if he allows another body to take its place? I mean, you always have to have two bodies. So in a sense, it is a relation.
Okay, so I think here the distinction between dispositions and dispositions manifesting themselves is important. So for Locke, solidity is a power type property, and a lonely corpuscle will have it, whether it manifests itself or not. Think of it as analogous to the for Locke, what he calls a secondary quality of colour. Secondary quality is a power that some bodies have. A secondary quality of yellow, say, is the power that some bodies have to cause the idea of yellow in us. Now, if there are no perceivers, that idea is never caused. The disposition is never manifested, right? So if there are not two bodies in the universe, then no body is ever prevented from entering the same place as the lonely corpuscle.
So So how can you know if it's solid or not? I mean,
well, that's a question about epistemology. That's a question about knowledge of solidity. And Locke says we know there are solid things because we interact with things. There is more than one body, and we learn about solidity from our senses, and from that we transductively infer that even the minutest parts of matter have this. Okay, it's a good question because it helps us focus on what Locke really thinks solidity is.
Yeah,
it's definitely not a relational property. And this has got actually implications for Locke's view about the nature of space as well. Yeah.
Claudia.
So I have two questions.
Yeah.
The first thing for this is, according to the cohesion, also applies to atoms. And if not, that means atoms are not extended to cohesion.
Yes.
And the second was about the interpretation ability of cause. Whether it makes sense to take those arguments about the integration of bodies as helping Locke's case when he's building the case from the bottom up, and you start with impenetrable solid atoms that cohere, and then interpretation can, for someone that starts like that, and then gets to body using cohesion as a principle of integration, of course, you know, interpretation is not an option, and that's what body is. And with that, at first my sort of option, I thought it just meant Hooke and I, and we start from bodies like Riemann pumps, and then we explain it down to the atoms, and then we talk at all. But if you start from atoms, then I don't think that we can do that at all. And of course, you know, the arguments you gave support that, because they were, you know, they are consequences of this view.
I'm not quite sure what the second question is. Let's start with the first one and we'll come back to the second one. So the first question has to do with, are there extended simples for Locke? Now this is a difficult question, and Locke really kind of fudges on this. He wants to say that to be extended is to have cohering parts, right? But he also wants to say, I don't know whether there are ultimate atoms. But what he does say is that we have this conception of the smallest part of matter that there can be, right? Or that there is and that there can be. And that's enough. Whether it is in fact physically divisible or divisible by God is a separate question. All I need, says Locke, is this basic conception of the most basic part of matter, and that is solid. Whether it has hypothetical parts or actual parts, that's a debate I don't want to go into. Now, Locke was pressed on this, and in fact, in the fifth edition of the essay, which was published after Locke's death, there's a very important footnote on this point, which was added by Pierre Coste. Issue was raised by a Frenchman. And so this appears in the fifth edition and then in the second French edition, which was published much later. So I refer you to that. But all that Locke really says there is, again, I'm not going to commit myself on infinite divisibility versus atomism. And if you want to deny that we have this conception of a most basic part of matter, well then, we can't go any further. The discussion's over. So you've put your finger on a weakness in Locke's theory, and in a sense, this is the very point at which Locke and Leibniz are really just completely different. Leibniz wants to use the power of the continuum for somehow giving his account of his motion explanation of cohesion, whereas for Locke, he wants to use this conception of a basic, fundamental part of matter which has solidity, whether it's divisible by God or by physical means or not. Okay, so it's a good question, and ultimately I think Locke admits that he doesn't have an answer to it, but he says if we can't take this simple notion, you understand in having asked the question, then we can't have a dialogue. Now, what was the second question you asked?
The second question is how you can use the principle of to bolster Locke's argument here, when it seemed to me that all he was saying is that, you know, bodies cannot overlap because they have this property. They are impenetrable parts of matter that hang together. So in a sense, he's already using this notion to reveal the principle that can't be invisible.
Yes, so look, that's a good question. I don't think we can't actually answer that for Locke. What he's got is he's got this account of solidity and cohesion and extension. They all, those three notions all bundled together. And he's got this principle that there are just three types of substances, God, finite minds, and bodies, and they can all occupy the same place. God can be in me now, but another body can't, another material body can't be in me. So he's got, that's an exclusion principle. Now, is that an a priori principle that he just sets out in order to set up his theory of identity over time? Or has he arrived at that through reflecting on the nature of cohesion, extension, and solidity? He doesn't tell us. And the way that it works in the essay, remember the discussion of personal identity and identity over time comes in the second edition, and much of the material we've looked at in cohesion and solidity is already all laid out in the first edition. It does seem to me that if you look at Locke's own intellectual development, the principle of individuation is really just a kind of stipulation about this is the way things are. If then Locke really says it. If they're not like this, we can't individuate anything. Okay? If there's infinite bodies occupying the same place that I'm occupying, well, you know, there's infinite gods, there's infinite finite mind. I mean, it's just, it's a disaster. We've got to lay out these principles of individuation, and this is one of them. And I'm saying, well, that reflects back on, in fact, bolsters his doctrine of repletion to the point that it entails the possibility of inner penetration.
Mikina,
question.
You said that Locke prefers solidity in front of impenetrability. Is there any way to put them together and to discuss about impenetrable solidity, for instance? I'm asking this because someone adds footnotes to Jacques Rolle's treatise on physics, he's saying that what this Cartesian should have added to the properties of matter would have been impenetrable solidity.
Yes. Well, this is a discussion in the 1660s in amongst natural philosophers, amongst Cartesians in France, and also amongst natural philosophers in England. It's a question that comes up in Boyle's Origin of Forms and Qualities, which was published in 1666-1667, two different editions. It's an issue about which lots of people were thinking, what is impenetrability, what's its relation to solidity and to hardness. Where Locke's coming from is he's developing a theory of ideas. And he said, we've got this idea from the senses, you know. I've just got it then. I just sensed solidity. But now we need to name the idea. What's the most appropriate name that we give to what I've just sensed? So the ideas come in. The idea is there in the understanding, and it is a sensory idea, so it's tagged as from the senses rather than from memory. And what do I call it? Well, Locke says, let's call it solidity, not impenetrability. And my preference for solidity is because it's a positive notion. Impenetrability is too negative. That's all he says. Right? So he's not doing any conceptual hair splitting, saying, well, actually, bodies are impenetrable because they're solid, or bodies are solid because they're impenetrable. He's not doing that at all. He's saying we've got the one idea, and we've got two names, let's choose the positive and not the negative name. So that's, I think, all we can do for Locke. If we want to have a more sophisticated analysis and think, well, maybe we can do some hair splitting, that's going to be on our own sort of speculative views. Or it may be that we can dig something out of the early drafts of the essay where he does seem to be considering these two notions and take it from there.
Chen, I think.
So, from what I gather, in the conclusion, you
your treatment of Leibniz is that he does basically come up with a way of in the one of the future, he basically uses motion as cause of cohesion.
Yes.
The thing, and I just had maybe a philosophical or methodological question. So
yeah.
That is another case of Leibniz sort of reducing complex phenomena to maybe a simple, more simple phenomena. So the issue is there then that rectilinear motion can handle like a wide range of different things.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see any kind of counterpart that plays to the simplicity of solidity that is developed from the idea side of on the side of the clock, for example? This relation between reducibility of concept versus the reducibility of ideas. And then maybe just as a second thing, you had mentioned some, you had mentioned in the beginning of the talk experimental,
yes.
Say, background.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if you could.
I can't remember the details of the experimental background. There is an article on this which points out, many years ago, which points out that Locke really does seem to have misunderstood the experiments which are reported by in the Saggi by the natural philosophers in the Academia del Trimento. To tell you the truth, I haven't followed up the critique of Locke's analysis. I've just taken this person's word for it. It does, we could look at the passage, I don't think it's worth digressing with that, but it does look like Locke's a little bit confused about the experimental report. On the other point, the question of sort of simplicity, I think that there is a difference here, that Leibniz is going for a reductive explanation in a way that Locke's not. What Locke has is a kind of tangle of notions that are sort of interdefined, and because of that, he draws a very pessimistic conclusion. We don't have clear and distinct ideas of cohesion, extension, and the nature of matter itself. So Locke's in a sense got a different agenda, and he is saying there is this monadic, it's my term, monadic property of single place property of solidity. Now Leibniz, and as you rightly say, Leibniz's reaction to that is, well, look, we don't need it. When God made the world, he didn't make the world and then add solidity. All we need is motion. We need the planum, an infinitely divisible matter, and motion. Forget solidity. We get it for free once we get the motion. So there's a reduction, a reductive move, but there's also, I mean, you know, Leibniz is taking this not just with solidity, with lots of other things as well. So I think that we've got really two quite different agendas here. We've got Locke thinking through this conceptual tangle in terms of his theory of ideas, and throwing his hands up in the air and saying, well, I give up. And Leibniz saying, don't give up. We can give a reductive analysis of this, and look, this, you know, no need to posit forces like Newton, no need to posit interpenetration. We can do it all with rectilinear motions. So, you know, they're really doing two quite different things, and as we see, they give quite different analyses. For Leibniz, it's all about states of matter. If something is cohering, all we're really saying is that, all we're really talking about is the sorts of motions that we're able to use to define what it is. For Locke, if something's cohering, well, we don't really know what that is, but if it is cohering, then we know that it's extended. So yeah, I mean, I think that this, you know, your question brings out nicely the completely different agendas of the two philosophers. We need to keep that to the forefront of our mind. They are not writing books about or essays on the nature of solidity, really. It's a big long digression for Locke, and it's a kind of haphazard set of comments for Leibniz in the USA and elsewhere. And I think that, you know, that's part of the reason why, as far as I know, in the secondary literature, there is no treatment of Leibniz on cohesion, at least in this later period.
Are there explanations of cohesion in terms of motion,
yeah,
and attraction?
Yeah.
Why would Locke not engage with such explanations? Were they not around at that time? Or if they were, why wouldn't he leave them aside?
Okay, good question. I think that what we get in Locke is a kind of there's a bit of a lag in Locke. So Locke writes the essay with a fairly strict mechanistic conception about the nature of change and causal interaction within nature, and it's all happening in the sort of billiard ball impulse model, so that we explain everything by analogy with the functioning of machines in terms of impulse. We don't need to appeal to antipathies, sympathies, occult qualities, or action at a distance. However, he very soon realizes that Newton's achievement has changed the whole game. And he acknowledges this to Stillingfleet, as Leibniz points out, and he points this out also in the Theodicy. I don't know if you know the text of the Theodicy, but he mentions the Stillingfleet correspondence again there and in another place. So Leibniz was quite sort of taken by this concession on Locke's part. But Locke never actually allowed the content of the essay, these physical considerations in the essay, which develop in relation to his theory of ideas, he never allowed them to catch up with his acceptance of these new discoveries in the science of his day. So you put your finger on a point at which Locke, he was basically just too old, and my view is he's too old and too, it's just too much work to rewrite the whole thing. Now, I don't think this just applies to the appropriation of forces, particularly, let's say, action at distance or non-mechanical modes of explanation. It also applies to the use of principles. So the book, the chapter in book four of Maxims, the whole of book one, it's against principles. It's against innate practical principles and against innate metaphysical principles. The whole of the book, the whole of the essay is anti-principles. And what does Newton do? He writes a book called Principles, Principia. And not only does he get the principles right, they start to generate new knowledge. Locke's saying we don't generate knowledge using principles, folks. So there are no innate principles. And Newton comes along and says, hey, folks, I'm generating new knowledge by principles. And Locke goes, oh, no. But he never has time. I mean, this is my take on Locke. He never has time to rewrite the essay to in a sense, to take back what he'd said and to rework it. So you put your finger on it, in a sense, a second dimension to this, that the science got ahead of Locke, and he was never actually able to incorporate the changes.
Right, but that's about attraction. But what about motion? What is Locke's mechanistic notion, right? Sort of motion as a cause of cohesion, as Leibniz would later on.
For Leibniz's explanation, you need a planum, and Locke doesn't have a planum. Locke is... Locke's not interested actually in developing a kind of physics. He's just got a basic billiard ball model, a sort of Boylean corpuscularianism, and with the mechanical principles of mechanical explanation, and that's it. He's not trying to do a physics, and he doesn't have a theory of motion as such. He's got a fairly basic idea of motion's a primary quality. It's a simple idea, and that's it. Remember, Locke's giving us an account or a theory of the understanding, the intellectus. He's not giving us a physics, but he's got all these really interesting digressions from which we can see his interaction with people who were doing serious work in natural philosophy, celestial dynamics and so on. But good questions. Yeah, really good questions.
I'd like to ask or make a comment, I don't know, that I'm making, well, not actually ask a question. Let me just put it in a question form and make it short. In the question form, it's again emphasizing something that I think Jen has said already. How much is Locke actually responding to actual experiments of decades earlier? Because Royal Society was at some point very much into experiments about cohesion. Okay, you in one of your quotes, the two marble discs appeared there, but that's just one of many other examples that everyone was sort of very interested in. So can you not sort of see this story about solidity as an attempt to respond to a scientific problem that was on everyone's minds in the 1960s, 70s?
I've already mentioned that the fact that Locke uses it raises the issue of impenetrability and its relation to solidity suggests a sensitivity to that debate that had gone on. That's more of a sort of conceptual rather than experimental issue. He does allude to the Cimento experiments, which in the chapter on solidity, I think, 2-4. So he's clearly thinking about experimental evidence. He probably has Boyle's set of experiments in view, which he cites in a number of other works, but not in the in the essay itself. I think that at every turn, Locke is aware, and Locke has in the background of his thinking, recent experimental work. Not just going back to the 1660s, but recent experimental work. And a nice example of this is the Gry, which I have been working on, Locke's unit, standard of measure for length.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Locke in the late 1670s and the 1680s, he has a definition of the Gry. Then he reads Newton's Principia and reviews it in the Bibliothèque Universelle in 1688, and then he has to change his definition of the Gry. Why? Because as Newton points out, Richier's experiments, observations on the Seconds Pendulum at KN in 1672 show that the Seconds Pendulum is not a universal standard of length. It varies with latitude. So Locke makes a change to his definition of the Gry in the essay on the basis of some very recent experimental results. Where did he find out about those? He found out about those from Toinat, but the fact that Newton cites them in the Principia, I think, was the decisive thing that made him change and ultimately have to really give up on his universal standard of length. So that's a nice example of the fact that really recent experimental work done by the French in this case, was impinging on the essay as it was being written. And I think that the more we look, the more examples of this kind we find. Having said that, I do need to do more work on experiments relating to cohesion and their impact on
this
passage.
And let me just continue, because recent experiments related to cohesion would involve what we call now superficial tension. This is what Newton was interested in, which is completely in a different frame of mind that shows that there is an attractive force, short range attractive force that is neither like gravity nor like electricity, and all these plates experiments, and then those cannot be sorted out in terms of solidity.
Yes. Well, I don't know if Locke knew about that.
Mm-hmm.
He had trouble with Book 2, the Principia. He really only seems to have got a handle on the arguments against the vortex theory. So the stuff on fluid mechanics, I don't think he had a handle on. And Newton's essay on acids, and Alkmaar's, well, it's on acid, the nature of acids, sorry, is circulating because Newton gave it to Pitcairn in 1692. I don't know any of the evidence that Locke ever saw that. So that led to a whole new set of theories of forces which could be used to explain chemistry or physiology. So. But I don't think Locke has anything to do with that that aspect of Newtonianism. But it's a good question. I do need to look more into experimental work on cohesion, marvelous lab experiments and so on.
Just small comment, in the early Leibniz, he has a theory of cohesion. He's part of this new physical.
This is pre-76.
Yeah. This is 71. It's explained by bubbles. So there are these kind of air bubbles that kind of bubble around and they push things together once pushed together, because nature opposed the vacuum, they don't want to separate.
Okay.
So it's kind of like a pneumatic kind of traction theory.
Mm-hmm.
I think he thought the hooks were too crude.
Okay.
So,
if it's a traction theory, maybe he's beating up on his former self as well as he's attacking this view. That's interesting. I didn't know that at all. I'm not going to venture into the early life. It's just too dangerous.
Right. Oh, hey.
Yeah, see, Leibniz really has a Cartesian problem. Matter is infinitely divisible, right?
Yeah.
How do you make sense of it? And that story of the particles flying off, that what counts for the solidity of the particles, what the fact that they hold together.
Yeah.
I mean, the problem never ends. It's this exact same problem with Descartes. And, the idea that they're all moving together is Descartes' idea that solidity is relative rest.
Yeah.
So, it's really you can't do much with it. Whereas, I think Locke seems to be more willing to admit that he has a problem.
Yes.
It almost seems like he's stuck with sort of relative rest too, but he's more willing to say there could be stuff going on that I don't know.
Yeah.
And so it seems like that's more food for take on.
Well, I agree with that. I mean, I think that we use this analogy often in philosophy, the bulge in the carpet problem. The bulge in the carpet, if you're laying carpet in a room and you've got a bulge, push, flatten the bulge out, right? You get up, you go, it's all done, and then it's appeared somewhere else. Leibniz has this chronic problem, bulging carpet problem. Locke faces it head on and says, okay, here is my epistemic limits. Here are my conceptual commitments. Where do we go from there? And unfortunately for Locke, he has a very pessimistic outlook. Others could have been much more positive about this. For Leibniz, he's so smart that it's very hard to catch him, but the harder we press, the more it's likely we're going to see the bulge appear. Now, let me just say, in the background here, and I think this is really important to appreciate, we've got an old way of viewing the problem of matter being replaced by the new way. And the old way is to say, well, what are the necessary and sufficient conditions for something to be a material thing? That's got to be solid, it's got to have mobility and emotional rest and so on. List them out. The new way, and I like to think of Catherine Brading's law constitutive approach as a way of framing this, is to say, and you heard me say this at the beginning of the month in Western, the new way is to think about, well, what is it that obeys the laws of motion? What is it that we can apply these laws to, and that's a much richer conception. And Locke's kind of caught in the middle. He starts off with the necessary and sufficient conditions approach to thinking about matter. Newton comes along, and there's a whole new thing going on. What's the status of gravity? No one ever thought of that, or very few ever thought of that as being really important for understanding what matter is. But Locke just had, he was just too old at that point to jump on the new game, in a sense. Probably didn't have the mathematical skills either to do it. But again, that transition is slightly, to some extent, encapsulated by the two different methodologies. You've got Leibniz, this brilliant mathematician and what we call a physicist, and Locke, the sort of guy into conceptual analysis. of the old school. And I think that is a nice kind of framework for comparing the differences, different approaches to this problem and to many others.
Right, if there are no other pressing questions, I would like to end up with two concluding remarks, or one concluding remark. Please join us in a more informal part of the discussion, which will take place at Siegfried, very close by. You can walk there together, because there are at least three reasons to celebrate. One is that we had had a successful workshop. The second is that we have just ended our fifth year of the Chelfis seminar. And the third is that our colleagues, Vlad Alexandrescu and Igor Evida, have published the second volume of Descartes' Correspondence.
Whoa!
And thank you, Peter, again.